Very good morning. I hope you can hear me because we are here in our Emofi, the psychological fest which we love to have. 2 years we couldn't have it. We are back again with it. And as you can see, so many people are throwing tantrums. Let's go into a room and continue over there. So give them a...
Yes, I'll give them a view and bring them.
Yes, here we are. I think you are all aware the topic is tantrums. The moment we say tantrums, we associate it with small children, right? Oh, this kid, you know, is always throwing tantrums. This child is very, very unruly and stuff like that. But today I want to talk about adults who throw tantrums. We don't even realize it. We don't use that particular, title. With children it's very easy, you know. Immediately a child does something, we say, oh, he's throwing tantrums. When and how does it start? Let me take off from there and we'll move on to whatever happens in adult life. There's this phrase which they use called terrible twos. What happens when a child crosses the first year and crosses the second year? By that time his vocabulary has been built up. He can speak a lot of words. He understands what to say when, what works in terms of saying something, what doesn't work. So, and that is about the same time when he realizes that I am not going to get everything that I demand. When he was tiny, when he was in the crib, all he had to do was to scream, cry, and immediately there would be some mummy or somebody coming to take care of his needs. In fact, in the first year or so, the child did not even have to tell what is wrong. It was the duty of mummy to find out what is wrong, whether the child is crying because he is hungry, because he is wet, because he wants to be lifted up. And mummy would take care of it. So here was this guy thinking that I am the ultimate, I am the prince and I am the greatest person in this world and I am the center of the universe. Anything and everything that I want is given to me on a pedestal. And I get whatever I want. Slowly, as I said, the child learns how to talk. So the child has to communicate. Now that the child has learned to talk, people expect him to say what he wants. I am hungry. I want this. I want that. So like that, the expectation of people goes up that I want to know what I want, need to express what I want, and then only I will get it. Okay, fine. Nothing wrong with that. But when the child expresses something and says, I want this, 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 and the adults, the parents feel that no, he should not be given that, then what happens? Slowly that discipline factor comes in. He is taught that you cannot, just because you asked for something, just because you made a demand, it doesn't necessarily mean that you are going to get it. So he starts saying, I want chocolate. Okay, mommy obliges and says, okay, here's one chocolate. Then he says, I want more and more chocolates. Mommy at that point says, no, enough, you're not getting it. If there are 10 chocolates, he says, I want all 10 of them. And mummy said, no, you have to share. And he said, why should I share? I want all the chocolates. And then the rift and the struggle starts. Now the child is a tiny little fellow. And he is looking up at all the adults who are giants in front of him. So when he wants something and they say that, no, we are not going to give you what you are asking for, what is his means to try and achieve what he wanted? How does he do that? He will try to cry, request, plead. It doesn't work. Then what does he do? He starts what we refer to as throwing tantrums. A tantrum typically is when a child starts repeating the same thing in a very negative, high-pitched voice and making demands which just go on and on and on, and the child refuses to see reason, refuses to be distracted, and only focuses on what I want and just gets stuck to what he is wanting. So what happens at that point of time? Sometimes the elders oblige, sometimes they don't, and they say, no, whatever you say, whatever you do, we are not going to give this to you, we are not going to oblige. Now he says that I was shouting, I was screaming, I am not getting it. So what is the next method? Maybe I'll pick up something and throw. Maybe I'll sit down on the ground and start screaming. Maybe I'll go and bang my head against the wall. I have to try out new innovative ways to make the elders oblige and give me what I want, right? In some cases, the elders say, no, you can shout, scream, you can bang your head, you can do whatever you want, we are not giving it to you. But remember that in many, many, many other cases, what actually happens is they get fed up and they oblige. About this fellow making such a racket, he's not allowing me to do anything, give it to him and be done with it. Sometimes it could be things like you are in a public place, you have taken this child to the mall, and there are so many people watching, or you are in a party or somewhere, and you are in the park, and this child is throwing tantrums. So the first thing that happens is that you start looking around. You start observing how others are reacting, and you start feeling very ashamed. You start feeling very uncomfortable. And only to ensure that you don't become a spectacle in front of others, you oblige. The same thing happens even at home. The neighbor has come and you value that neighbor who's a respectable person and you like that person. You're trying to create a good impression, and that is when he will throw tantrum because he knows that you will not be comfortable creating a bad image. Mummy's mother-in-law may come and she has a lot of expectations from her daughter-in-law how to bring up the child, and the child starts throwing tantrums. Mummy has no choice but to give in. So what happens is that whenever people start giving in to tantrums, the child realizes that this is a good way of getting things done, and that sort of, you know, carries on and on. It keeps increasing. The more the adults think that let us bargain for peace, let us just give up and let go, it's nothing very great. And also remember, one reason why adults give in is because the demands of a 2 year, 4 year, 6 year old child are very minor. It could be a chocolate, it could be an ice cream, it could be this particular toy or something. But what they don't realize is that this is building up the foundation for bigger and greater demands. And as the child grows, if he realizes that tantrums is a very good way of getting results, slowly what does he do? He starts using it as a weapon to get what he or she wants. Now the child has come to teenage. As you know, teenage is, you know, referred to as peer age. They are looking to their friends, their colleagues, their classmates, and they want to have that sense of belonging with them. So anything that they don't get, they say that my friend, you know, is going to get money to have pizza, and I also need 500 rupees to go for that pizza party. And the parent says, no, it's too much money, it's not worth wasting so much money on one snack. And because he cannot go to his friend and admit that my parents are not giving me the money, it is so important to him that he starts throwing tantrums. And remember that as the child grows bigger, the result of his tantrums can be more and more effective. What happens is that the child slowly starts making bigger and bigger and more, stronger demands. And when that happens, parents slowly start losing ground. Child is growing up. He or she is becoming bigger and bigger. It becomes more and more difficult for the elders to physically stop the child. It could be parent, it could be teachers, it could be anybody for that matter. Including at times when a teenager throws tantrums with his or her friends. If you people don't listen to me, then I will, he starts becoming angry. And they say, we don't want to lose him, we don't want him to get so angry, so we will oblige him. That is how it moves on into bigger and bigger areas. The child will make demands for a mobile phone. Then within no time he will say, this has become outdated, I want the more expensive and the newer phone. Before he even turns 18, he already wants a motorbike. And he starts throwing tantrums. If you don't give me, I will not go to school, I will not go to college. He starts emotionally blackmailing. And when you find that you are not able to control the child, you are running into difficulties. I told you, he will say, I will not eat unless you give me what I want. I will not go to school, I will not study, I will not give the exam. So many weapons that the child has in his hand. He will use any of those to try and see how he can manipulate the elders. Now, if this happens, it carries on into adult life. That is the sad part. That when we are obliging a person in the growing years by giving him or her more and more and more, you know, allowing the person to get into tantrums, we are laying the foundation for an unreasonable adult. Most people who behave obnoxiously, who throw tantrums, who make unnecessary demands, who get violent, the foundation lies in their early years. When it was not so difficult to somehow get the person back on track, when you could have been a little more strict and firm and devised ways and means to suppress or to channelize or to get the person back on track, for some reason, mostly the reason is simple, it is fear. And it is that thing, what will people say, how will I manage this, unnecessarily things are getting unpleasant. Every day he is throwing tantrums, I am fed up, day in and day out, he has been making this demand for getting this. I think the only way I can get peace is to somehow give him what he wants and then I will be at peace. Yes, you will be at peace. For how long? Before you know it, he identifies something else that he wants, which is unreasonable, which is not what the adult wants to oblige. And if you again don't give in, the tantrums start all over again. At this juncture, I want to just digress for a minute to also tell you that sometimes tantrums can be aggravated if the child has got, you know, some of the developmental disabilities. For example, a child who has got OCD, obsessive compulsive disorder. Very strong possibility that that child may use tantrums as a means to get what he wants. Much more so with children who have got ADHD, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. As it is, his attention span is low, he cannot concentrate on one thing at a time. He is hyperactive, he wants to keep on doing something or the other new. And when he hits a block where he encounters somebody who says, no, I'm not giving this to you, I'm not going to oblige you, I'm not going to allow you to have it your own way, what happens? He starts increasing his tantrums. Because somewhere it was drilled into him in his earlier years that if you are throwing tantrums repeatedly and consistently, you get what you want. That is a fundamental flaw in dealing with rebellious children. To gain peace for that moment, you are giving up the peace of all the future dates. So that is one thing before I go deeper into understanding adults who throw tantrums and why and all that. Let us understand that if you are dealing with any child, if you are observing a child, you are teaching a child, you are counseling a child, or you are a parent of a growing child, please understand that whatever may be the price that you have to pay, make sure that you do not succumb to tantrums. And here comes one very important thing. It's applicable both to children as well as adults, which I'm going to speak about. Now, supposing this person makes an unreasonable demand. Please take some time to reflect over it. Don't react. Hold back and say, let me think it over. Let me see how to go about it. I am not promising you that I will give it to you. I am not saying that I will not give it to you. I want time. I want to think over. I will then respond to you. What happens is that it gives the person throwing the tantrums an opportunity to reflect. Otherwise, that person realizes that when I make a demand, I get it. Now, when you say, give me time, I want to think over it, what is happening is that even the person making the demand has those few minutes or few hours or whatever the time to reflect. Will I get it or will I not get it? If I don't get it, what happens? Is this a right way of getting whatever I want? What are the different ways? Am I hurting somebody by doing this? Am I making reasonable or unreasonable demands? When that happens, your response to the person can be much more rational. Now, when you have taken time saying that I will respond to you, okay, you made a demand, I will respond to you, give me time. Please understand one basic thing. If eventually you are going to give in to the child, it is better you give in right at the beginning. You may say, I don't like it. Given a choice, I would not like to oblige. But since you seem to be so keen, you seem to be so bent upon it, just to see that I don't hurt you, or just to ensure that we maintain good, loving relationship, it's okay, I will give it to you. But that, as I said, has to be done before you think that you need to, you know, ensure that. Do not, you know, start off by saying no. It's a very fundamental mistake which a lot of adults do. No, I can't give it to you. Don't be stupid. How can you make such demands? No, this is not possible. Don't be silly. What do you think? Money grows on trees? You think I've got nothing better to do? We make all these statements, the tantrum increases. And at one point, after that, if you give in, finished. All your efforts are gone. And the bottom line that comes to the person is, you only have to be persistent and you will get what you want. So that anyway goes on and on till the person becomes an adult. Now adults, when they throw tantrums, it can be much, much, much worse than children. Even within children, I told you, if a 5-year old is throwing tantrums, it will be for what? Maybe a chocolate, an ice cream, a small toy, or permission to sit and watch TV late in the night. Those are the type of demands which he will probably be making. Tantrums. But if the person grows up, now the person is an adult, and in the normal course, you are expecting that the adult will be rational, balanced, mature, but they are not. You remember earlier also I have spoken about the fact that this adolescence, the transfer from childhood to adulthood, in between phase, what we refer to as adolescence or teenage or whatever you want to label it, is the time when an individual is seeking an identity. Who am I? Where am I headed? What are my good qualities? What are my limitations? What are my achievements and what are my frustrations? Whom do I build good relationship with? Whom do I love and whom do I hate and whom do I want to be indifferent to? It just goes on and on and on. Years together, the person is looking for an identity. And if the person is guided correctly, if the person does sufficient introspection, if the person finds the right environment, the person goes on to becoming a responsible adult. But in many, many, many cases, that does not happen. Adolescence is over. Chronologically, this person has become an adult. He is 20 years, 40 years, 60 years. But that, you know, not having established an identity still remains somewhere deep down. And that is where you will find adults throwing tantrums, which can be much, much more, you know, difficult, because the person can become violent. An adult being violent can be much more horrifying than a child or even a teenager. To, you know, sulk, withdraw, can be much more painful than a child. You will have a child or an adolescent who is throwing a tantrum, getting very angry and saying, "You don't listen to me, I don't want to talk to you," and all that, goes into the room and bangs the door, puts on loud music and refuses to come out. Nothing great is going to happen. He'll spend some time, he'll get hungry, he himself will come out. And the way children and adolescents are, he'll change his mind and then he'll come and give a hug to his parent and say, "Okay, sorry," or something like that. But that doesn't happen with adults. Adults have their ego. Adults have their, you know, that strong mind which says that once I have said something, I am not going to give in. Including adults who do what we call as whining. "No, you never care. Nobody loved me. If you had loved me, you would have not said no to me. Nobody is bothered about whether I live or die. Why am I working so hard and slogging away to glory and nobody in the family?" This type of you know, what do you say, the whinings also take place. Anyway, these are different manifestations. The fact remains that the inner child of the person has not been satisfied. The inner child is still remaining inside and creating that ruckus, creating that unpleasantness, creating that thing of, you know, I am not happy. In transactional analysis, TA, this is referred to as, I am okay, you are not okay. Meaning to say, the whole world is bad. Only I am the good one and I am not getting what I want. That makes a person continuously throw tantrums. And there's another factor to it, I want you to keep that also in mind. When a person feels that he or she cannot express properly, the tantrums increase. When the person has the ability to express, that's one of the reasons why I go on and on emphasizing, teach your child to express emotions. In fact, right now in our Emofi Fest, which is going on, we have kept a counter where, you know, we have made all these funny faces and emoticons and we are asking people to take selfies about what am I feeling right now. And we are giving them some 30 different choices. So they will take this Emofi with, emoticon and hold the placard and take a selfie. Yeah, and they will remember that, you know, this is what I was feeling at that time and this is what it is. What is the idea of doing this? Even though the participants here in our fest are adults. But we are re-emphasizing the fact that you have to learn how to express your emotions. Become aware of your emotions and express them as much as you can. Here is Sonal with some of the emoticons. This is what we are giving them, and they are going to hold this up, identify what is the emotion behind it, and take a selfie to show that this is what I was feeling at that particular moment. As you can see, we are giving them the entire range. The idea behind this is that a person should be taught how to identify and express emotions. The more the person can do it, the less are the chances that the person will sulk, whine, throw tantrums, get violent, throw things. All that can be set right if we teach people. But in many cases, it does not happen. So here now you are encountering an adult. Grown-up person, otherwise capable in so many ways, and you expect mature manner, but that is not happening. So what do you do? First, if that person is important to you, please go into all the contributing factors right from childhood onwards. You will understand the do's and don'ts, you will understand why this happened, how it happened, what is the background of it. As we always, you know, say this thing called empathy, which is the why behind the what. What is he doing? He is throwing tantrums. He is throwing things. He is sulking. He is whining. Why is he doing it? What is the sentiment or the emotion behind that? Also remember that when there are near and dear loved ones, family members, and if they are passive, they allow this person to get away with his tantrums, it will increase. So somewhere you have to be aware of this. And amazingly, this person doesn't throw tantrums in front of public. Most people will say, oh, he is so well behaved, she is so quiet and disciplined, she is this, he is that. But only the people who know how he is, the near and dear or the loved ones, they are the ones who suffer. If there is any threat of violence, I always recommend get away from there. Don't allow a person to get violent. If it is not, you know, violence, if it is just unreasonable tantrums, don't try to use logic or don't engage him into a conversation at that time when he is emotionally hypercharged. Maybe you will nod your head, like I told you, no, instead of reacting, you just respond by saying, I need time, I want to think it over. Now this can be done if you, who is at the receiving end of the tantrums, realizes and accepts that this is not aimed at me, this is a deficiency in this person. That is why this person is doing it. So as long as I am safe, I am not going to engage, I am not going to get into arguments. In fact, I am going to reverse the way I was normally. I would have been a little strong in saying something, but now that this person has gone into that tantrum mode, I will now reverse my thing, become more and more, assertive. Ensure that you are not taking it up as a personal thing and you are not getting affected by it. And then talk to the person much later without accusations, without making the person feel as though you are interrogating or making him or her feel guilty. Later on, try to have a meaningful conversation. It works. There are a lot of people who throw tantrums, but if given opportunity, if they are given some one or two understanding people around them who help them to overcome it, it can be done. So that, in a simple language, is my message with regard to dealing with adults who throw tantrums. There are so many angles and so many variations. I'm sure many of you also have, you know, something to contribute and your experiences and all that. So all that we shall do, as they say in the TV serials, no? Break ke baad. I need a minute off.
Yes. Hello everyone. Seema is missing here for the break, right? But I am here to tell you that today afternoon we are looking forward, after this EMOFI fest gets over, to welcome all the DCS 23 batch who will be coming in for their inaugural class and boarding in for the whole year. Isn't it wonderful and exciting? Yeah? And timely we keep getting children for career guidance and aptitude test. Even here in the fest, if you can still come over, there's lots that happening live, because all this time it has been always the screen, but now it's the real people coming out. It's really wonderful to see everybody out. And let's get back to Ali.
Thank you, Sonal. Now Sonal is going to help me by highlighting what are the questions and comments that are coming from you. There are a lot of good mornings. Haider Naseem says good morning. Shivanand says good morning. Sarafsas says good morning. Jai Shri says very relevant topic in today's world. Yes, Jai Shri, because stresses, faster way of life, rat race, competitions, that frustration that is building up comes out sometimes in the form of these tantrums. I can't do anything about the circumstances in my office. I have a horrible boss. I have too much of targets and overwork. I am stressed out. I need relief. But I have not learned how to have relief. So what happens? I have a loved one. I have a family member. I have somebody close to me who is not obliging or who has different views on something which I want. Immediately I get into what we call as a tantrum mode. I start becoming unreasonable, I start becoming repetitive, I start raising my voice, and that is how it goes.
So, questions. In the meantime, I'll read out what Vidya has asked for. Few parents tell their children not to share food. Won't that give a negative impact in future, as if the child grows and continues not sharing practice, then that would be a bad, right, Ali?
Absolutely right. Not only food. A child has to be taught to share anything and everything. And particularly if it is a child growing up in a nuclear family. A single child. Sometimes even single parent. The smaller the family, the lesser are the chances of sharing, isn't it? If nothing else, if it is a joint family with grandparents living, if the child gets some sweet or chocolate or something, he is taught that as a matter of courtesy, you should go to Ajji, Tata, whoever it is, and offer them also. They may or may not take it, that's a different matter. But these are the courtesies and these are the formalities which are taught to a child, and he realizes that they are part of the family, they are elders, they need to be given that respect, and therefore I have to share it with them. Same thing with if a child has siblings, if a child has a brother or sister, very much you have to share with them. I recount that incident long back when I was quite small. Some uncle had come from, I think, abroad or somewhere and brought some very unique chocolates. Of course, at that time we had to share, so I took that box of chocolates and ensured that everybody got one chocolate, gave to everyone, and the balance that was left over, I wanted to hide it from my brother. And therefore, I went around the whole house. We used to live in our grandparents' house at that time. I went looking all over the house to find a safe place where I can hide those chocolates away from my brother. With great difficulty, I thought I had found the ideal place. Next morning, I woke up and the box of chocolates had disappeared. My brother was a better CID than I was. He had found it and he took it away. Now I got very angry. I went straight to him and I said, "You are a thief, you are a rascal, you are no good, you are a horrible fellow. I will not talk to you for the rest of my life." Ah, what a statement. And you know what he did? "Okay, I've got the chocolates, doesn't matter if you don't talk to me, bye." Okay, I went back, started playing with my toys. And I realized that playing alone is not at all a nice or a happy thing. So little while later, I went back to him and I said, "I'm still not talking to you, but come and play in this game." See how we learn life skills? See how we learn how to manage our emotions? And because I did that and I invited him and we started playing, after some time, he brought back half of those chocolates and gave it back to me. So I had to learn that I can't keep all of them. I got only half of them. Now this is what some of these children are missing out, and as you rightly said, if the parents themselves say that, don't share, I think that's a really bad thing that we are teaching. That child is going to be in trouble when the child grows up.
Navina has to say something.
Yes, really. Yes.
She says that the best way to teach the kids how to express your emotions is by role modeling to them. She says that she has been showing her emotions to her teenager son. "I cry, show my anger or irritation, and thankfully my son has learned to express his emotions."
Wonderful,
he
Navina.
She is saying, "Mommy, I'm angry too. I'm not feeling good as I'm bullied," and then we sit and chat about it.
Wonderful, Navina. I wish all of us learn to be role models in front of children. Most of the time, we are not even conscious. A couple who is having a fight and one of them starts throwing tantrums to the other and not even conscious about the impact that it is having on the child. Your spouse may take it easy saying, "Oh, this one is always throwing tantrums, it's okay, it doesn't matter, I can ignore it." But the child cannot do that. That is why role modeling is very important.
And Navina also says that she learned this move by doing counseling course at Banjara.
Thank you. Yes, Navina. True.
Latanjali says, "Thanks, Ali. So informative. Will help me in my sessions."
Yes, please do it. Wherever you are getting opportunities, those of you who are counselors, trainers, please keep these very basic things in mind and use them to just spread the message formally or informally.
Yeah, Renu says, "Sharing is caring."
Very true.
Shritapa says, how to manage a sulking adult who is not ready to let go of ego and pride and keep on doing the same?
Yes, initially, you know, you use the technique which we use in kite flying. You want to cut the kite of the other person. If you take it close and try to pull, it never happens. So what they say is, give a loose rope. Let your kite go higher and higher, and you know, let that sag come in. When the other person's kite comes close enough, then you pull and the thread of the other kite breaks. So give a loose rope to such a person. Initially start, it may look as though you are agreeing with it, with his ego, with his pride. Oh yes, I know you're so capable and others don't recognize your abilities. People don't give you what you want. Slowly he starts getting a little disarmed. Then you bring out to the person the factor that even if you're 100% right and other people are 100% wrong, in life you have to ask yourself a basic question. Is it more important to be right or is it more important to be happy? When you realize that happiness is 10 times more important than just proving that you are right, people slowly start changing. And the day that person does not throw tantrums or become sulking, as you rightly said, when the person is a little more outgoing compared to the other days when he was in that sulking mood, give a lot of appreciation. Involve the person in activities, in conversation. Appreciate what the person is doing, the behavior. Say, today I'm so happy sitting and talking to you or doing this activity with you. Roshan says, do you think a pampered child has more chances of showing tantrums as he grows older? Definitely yes, Roshan. The more you pamper a child, the more the child starts believing that I am the center of the universe, everything should revolve around me, I should get whatever I want. And in real life, as he grows up to becoming an adult, obviously the world is not going to give him what his parents were giving him unconditionally and by pampering him. Nobody in the world wants to pamper, not even your spouse. So what happens at that point of time? The person starts becoming rebellious, throwing tantrums, becoming violent and things like that.
Navneet has a contradictory,
yes.
Unlooked child and the home which gets less privileges compared to others gets more affected. The same thing happens in school where a child gets less privileges and amenities gets affected too.
Obviously, you know, the point is that we are always comparing ourselves with others. So if I feel that I am not getting what I want, I feel that I am, you know, not being given the privileges. For whatever reason, the other child may be coming from a rich family, so he gets to have certain things which I don't. The teacher may be being nice to the other student because the other student is, you know, studying well, so I feel bad. Now, here we teach the person the basic life skills, that is how to manage. If you can teach, again it comes back to what I told earlier, teaching the person the basics of, you know, the management of emotions. The more the person can manage and express emotions, the lesser are the chances that the person will grow up and continue to have tantrums.
Sandhya says, my daughter, 10 years old, she is not able to read and she has
learning disability.
She is not able to sit in the class. She is disturbing other children so regularly that she is getting complaints. Please advise.
That is definitely an issue to be looked into, Sandhya, that the child needs special attention because the child has certain special needs. There's no point in going on forcing that child and saying that you have to study, you have to do this, you have to get marks. Please get an assessment of the child done. If you're in Bangalore city, we have innumerable very good child psychologists and special educators who can do the assessment. We do it in Banjara also. If you want, you can come to us. Our Gurukul team will do the assessment. If you are not in Bangalore, then whichever city you are in, at least the bigger cities, all of them now have very competent special educators or child psychologists. Get an assessment of the child done, then you will realize, you know, what are the needs of the child. And if you deal with the child accordingly, you will find that the behavior of the child also comes down. It is basically that thing like the, you know, Tare Zameen Par, that as long as the teacher was not willing to, you know, accept and was going on scolding the child, even his behavior pattern came down because he was not studying purposely, but because the words were dancing in front of him, right? That is what we need to do.
Yeah. Reno says many people don't react to tantrums, ignore and remain silent. Then the reactions of the child will be worse than let me close.
No, it depends what you mean by ignoring. If I were in front of a child or even an adult who is throwing tantrums, and if I just express by my body language, by my eye contact, okay, you are throwing tantrums, you choose to behave in this particular manner, this is what you want, but I am not going to be a party to it. So I am going to ignore it, I've got better things to do and I will move on. If that message is conveyed to the person that I know that you are throwing tantrums, I disapprove of them and that's the reason why I'm not doing it. And as I told you earlier, you should back it up with, whenever the person concerned is not throwing tantrums, please go out of the way to be nice to that person, express your love, interact as much as possible, so the person, you know, learns what they call as the carrot and stick policy. When you are good, you get a carrot, which means you get a reward, you get something to eat. When you are not good, you get a stick, meaning to say you get some punishment or you get ignored and these things.
Shivanand says, does single child parents face this challenge more than others?
Yes, possibly. I'm not saying that every time it happens. I just want to be aware. So, nuclear family versus joint family. Single child versus children with siblings. Single parent child compared to a child who has got both parents living with him or her. These are all parameters which we need to be aware of. I'm not putting a label saying that such children will have tantrums or will not be, you know, growing up in a rational manner. But you need to take a little more precautions if any of these things are there.
Navina says, I think when the child or adult is receptive,
talk to that person.
Why is demand should be
there? Yes. Yes.
Can we defer it?
Yes. Teach that person what we call as delayed gratification, which is becoming so much rare. You want pizza, if you are willing to wait till Sunday and you behave yourself nicely, you don't throw tantrums, on Sunday we will get pizza of your choice. That is how you are teaching delayed gratification to that particular individual. Sandhya says, I am in Bangalore, then you are most welcome, Sandhya. You have our, you know, website and email ID, you have our telephone numbers. Please get in touch and we will sit and discuss what can be done to give a better future to your child.
And Renu says, the frustration inbuilt when adults due to autocracy, if you don't react or reflect.
Yes. These are all factors to be. What I would say is we need to balance it. Okay. All aspects which are concerned with the emotional well-being, you can use the simple example of physical well-being. Being deprived of food can have horrible consequences. Overeating can have horrible consequences. So what do? We eat, but we restrict ourselves to the amount that has to be eaten, the balance that has to be created, the time lag between one meal and another. All these factors go. The same thing applies in human relationships and dealing with people's emotions.
Shivanand says, recently your article on your Facebook page, Ali, when you want to say disagree with someone, but don't start immediately with a no.
Yes.
Start with a yes.
Yes. I had given the example of that serial which had come very long back called Yes Minister. It was a hilarious serial where there is a minister who is not a very competent person, and he has a secretary. And he has this habit of calling a secretary and giving very ridiculous instructions. Do this, get that done, issue these orders. The secretary had a very nice way of dealing with the boss, which was by saying, "Yes, Minister." Whatever he says, his first words would be, "Yes, Minister. I will immediately go and open the file and I will look into ways and means of doing it, and I will find out if it is possible to get this done. And the moment I find this, I will get the file to you for signature." All that he will say. And then slowly he will come back to saying, "This doesn't fit in with the rules. This is not within your powers. This can lead to negative connotations." And one going on and on and on till the minister would start saying, "Yeah, I think then in that case it is difficult. I think in that case we should not do." "Yes, Minister. What a good idea that you have said that we should not do it." So he would pamper the ego of the minister and make him feel as though it was his decision not to do it. You have to watch that to understand how it can be done even with a very, very unreasonable adult who is a boss, who is his minister. It can be done at home, it can be done with a spouse, it can be done with anybody like that. Yes, Naveena, communication is the key. I agree with you. The more you interact, the more the other person feel understood and loved and given importance, hence less tantrums. I would remind you that I spell communication as L-I-S-T-E-N. The more you listen to a person, even the earlier questions which were there, that what do you do if somebody is sulking, somebody is unreasonable, somebody is constantly throwing tantrums, somehow make the person talk. And these people who throw tantrums, no, they love to talk. They like to go on and on and on, shouting, screaming, repeating themselves 10 times. "You know what happened, you know I did this, you know that fellow did that," something like that, it goes on. But the better a listener you are, the better are the chances that you can get over that person. Now, when you find that a person is adult, throwing tantrums and is just not listening to any reasonable things, you've tried your best. You've tried different ways and means. When you need to accept that at least in the short run this person will not oblige, please think of two alternatives. If the tantrums are not harmful, if they are not violent, if they are not causing very deep pain, if they are not causing embarrassment or shame in front of others, then learn how to cope. Very often we need to cope with unreasonable people in our lives, hoping that someday they will change and someday they will become more reasonable. But I would also like to tell you that if the tantrums become violent, if they become very abusive, if they start hitting out at your personal identity and your well-being, if they can cause physical damage either to you or to some other vulnerable family member, it could be against an elderly parent, it could be against a small child, wherever this sort of thing is happening and you have taken all the efforts to try and bring the person around, but the person doesn't seem to be obliging you in any way, then you have to learn how to move away from that person and from that relationship. Sounds very difficult. Sounds, heartbreaking. There are 100 factors to be looked into. What about the children's future? What about this? What about that? But it is better to start thinking, if not immediately, in the long run, because I don't want to constantly continue suffering. So can I start taking those steps of trying to either emotionally insulate myself or physically separate from that person so that I don't have to keep suffering like this.
But if this person is your loved one and where you cannot physically separate,
yes,
or emotionally guardian, that time what do you worry?
Emotionally, we can always insulate ourselves from anybody. People can control your actions, people can control your words, people can control your purse strings. They cannot control your mind. So if you decide that I have put in enough efforts, this person continues to throw tantrums, continues to be unreasonable. As I mentioned earlier, I have to remind myself that this is not my personal failure. It is not something which I have done. This is a fault in the other person, and therefore I have to protect myself. I have to emotionally insulate myself. I have to focus more on the positive relationships and the good people that I have in my life, and I need to create that balance.
So what I understand is we need to be continuously aware of what's happening with us within.
Correct. Absolutely right. Renu has a good suggestion. Please speak about social psychology sometime, as we need to learn and react. Yes, I do intend to do that, Renu. Thanks for giving the suggestion. We will take it up. In fact, as an extension of that, I don't know how many of you are aware that the world of economics, which was earlier purely a sort of mathematical concept, what are the benefits, financial benefits, what happens if you do that, where is the profitability highest, where do you get basic long-term benefits and all that. Today it is moving more and more towards what they are referring to as social economics or behavioral economics, meaning to say that people will behave in different ways. Why a stock market share goes up and down? Why do people decide to invest money in Ponzi schemes and they get cheated out of it? Why do countries take certain economic decisions which take them to a downfall and then they suffer very badly? It is more to do with the behavioral, the social and the psychological aspects rather than the psychometrics, which is pure calculation and which says this is better than that and here the profitability is higher. It doesn't work that way. Yes, so we need to be more aware of these issues and we will take them up one by one. In fact, this thing called behavioral economics is something which has fascinated me since a long time. But when this gentleman Thaler, T-H-A-L-E-R, you can Google him, T-H-A-L-E-R, Thaler, when he won the Nobel Prize of Economics for behavioral economics and understanding the social and emotional aspects of economics, from that day onwards, I have been very fascinated with this and I have been doing whatever, lots of reading up on it. I will share with you whatever my opinion, my learning and my impressions are, and we can all, you know, inculcate that as part of our lives. The same way as we can inculcate sometimes very unreasonable people, people who throw tantrums, people who keep, you know, getting into conflict situations. As long as we understand that it is nothing personally to do with us, I can handle this and I will handle this. Navina has given another very nice suggestion on topic, how to positively and effectively communicate so that you are taken in the right spirit. Yes, I think taking off from yes minister, we can have a session on this communication where, you know, without antagonizing somebody, without getting into conflict and without giving up, how is it that we can ensure that our views are put across and people don't take us for granted and people don't ignore us. This is definitely, as Renu says, our social responsibility, and we will do something about it. It's our little endeavor, as you know, we meet up, on these Saturday mornings. And today, despite the fact that I am right in the middle of this wonderful Emofi Fest, where we have literally hundreds of people coming in and a lot of youngsters, I'm very happy to see so many young students who are coming in to learn more and more about, the emotions, about psychology, about relationships. I think that's a very good sign. Instead of everybody running madly towards the same rat race and the same herd mentality, I salute all these youngsters, and I'm going to go back to them, and I'm going to be speaking also to them. It's going to be a very nice, promising Saturday, the rest of the day and the weekend. And I wish you people also a very good weekend forward and a week forward, because next week I'm coming out with another very, very interesting topic, which is about women. And women have always been very fascinating for me since the time I was 4 or 5 years old. I started very early. So my research on women comes out next Saturday with the topic about what happens when women, they grow up, they mature, they come to midlife, their responsibilities and all that. How do they deal with the thing? Yes, Navina, I'll end up with her quote. She said, "I learned recently, say thank you for waiting patiently rather than say sorry for being late." See, it's such a good, simple communication. These are the little things of life that we should all be sharing with each other. And we will continue to do this sharing. Thank you for a patient listening and a wonderful, committed and dedicated group of people. Most of you who do come live every Saturday morning, and then the much, much more huge numbers who catch up later, because they may be busy on Saturday mornings, and who catch up later and then they observe this thing. My humble thanks and my salutations to all of you. Let this be a mutual learning, and let us have a wonderful life ahead. Okay? Bye-bye.